discussion tonight is friendship across the aisle with our two special guests. I think this is a timely topic for an election year. So the event tonight is sponsored by the American Enterprise Institute and the Baugh Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, and also in association with the Institute for Study of Religion and Honors College. Tony Hall served in the U.S. House of Representatives for more than 20 years for the state of Ohio as a Democrat. From 2002 to 06, he was also a United States Ambassador to United Nations for and agencies for food and agriculture, among others, many other titles. He's also worked in the Middle East Peace Initiative in collaboration with the Centers for the Study of the Presidency. Currently, he is the director for the Alliance to End Hunger, and he also serves on the Board of Advisors of Opportunity International, a charity that seeks to end poverty through microcredit. Now, one little-known fact about Tony is in college at Denison University, Hall was named the Little All-American Football Tailback and the Ohio Conference's Most Valuable Player. So I just wanted you to know that we haven't forgotten that.
And I did.
Very, maybe his most prestigious honor. Frank Wolf, our other guest, is a Republican former legislator who represented Virginia's 10th congressional district in the U.S. House of Representatives from 1981 until his retirement recently in January 2015. He was the state's longest serving congressman, serving for 34 straight years. And he recently became the Jerry and Susie Wilson Chair in Religious Freedom here at Baylor University. He currently works with faculty at Baylor, along with the Institutes for the Study of Religion, on pressing religious freedom issues of the day. Our discussion tonight on Friendship Across the Aisle will be moderated by our own Dr. Elizabeth Corey, who's the director of the Baylor Honors Program and associate professor of political science. So I'll turn it over to you, Elizabeth.
Thank you, Steve. Well, I'd like to also welcome you all here and say thank you to all the sponsors of this event. It's a pleasure to be moderating. This is my first time ever as a moderator, so bear with me, but I'm looking forward to it. I had the pleasure of knowing Congressman Wolf last year when my husband, Dr. David Corey, and I taught a course with him on religious liberty. So we heard many stories about his friendship with Tony Hall, and that was actually a kind of a recurrent theme of the class. So it's tremendously exciting to have them both here on the same stage to talk about issues of religious freedom, of hunger, and of a number of other relevant topics. What we're also particularly interested in is figuring out how a Republican and a Democrat could have cultivated such an enduring and close friendship. This seems at some level in our current climate to be almost impossible. So what I would like to do is to ask them to talk a little bit about how this friendship came about, and that's the way we'll begin. Then we'll turn to some questions on substantive issues, and then at the end of of our time, we'll have some questions from the audience. But I want to begin with a quote I found in doing a little bit of research into the issue of partisan friendship across the aisle, and I came across a wonderful quote. It goes like this: "Compromise is difficult, but governing a democracy without compromise is impossible." Now, I think the two men on the stage here exemplify that kind of compromise in a truly remarkable way. So what I'd like to have them do is just tell us, me as the moderator and you all as the audience, to tell us a little bit about when you started meeting together, what brought you together, and how your friendship developed. And I will start with Mr. Wolf.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you for having us. Thank you for coming. Very briefly, I had run for Congress three times. I had lost in 76 and lost in 78 and won in 1980. I had always wanted to be in Congress. I stuttered very badly as a kid, and people would say, you know, you're never going to be able to make it. Well, 1980, I did make it. I grabbed Ronald Reagan's coattails, and he pulled me right across the line. My district is a marginal district. It was, if you've been to Washington and you flew into there, that was my district: Arlington, Fairfax, and Loudoun counties. Well, I was asked to join a small group, a covenant group, a Bible study group, and I wasn't quite sure. In the group was Tony, obviously, a Democratic member was Bill, was Dan Coats. Dan Coats is now a senator from the state of Indiana, and then a guy named Bob McEwen, who's a congressman from Ohio. My district was sort of targeted. I was a target of the Democratic Campaign Committee, and so the thought of sitting around with a Democratic member and sharing your most intimate feelings and just seemed out of, it was something that concerned me. Well, when you sit with somebody and when you pray with someone, and you then pray for someone, and you then break bread with them, over a period of time, the trust begins to take. We are to the point of many times I would have tough votes, and before I talk to my leadership, and I'm a conservative Republican, I would talk to Tony and talk to the group. Our wives are in a small covenant group together, his wife Janet, my wife, and with Joanne Camp, Jack Camp's wife, and a group of others who pray together. And so we then found ourselves traveling together. In 1984, I used to work on transportation issues and federal employee issues. In 1984, I got a call from Tony. He had just gotten back from Ethiopia, and he said, there's a famine taking place. Would you go? You should go. And I jumped on an airplane, went to Ethiopia. I'd never been out of the country. I've been to Canada before I got elected to Congress. I'm sure many of you have traveled much more than I could have ever even imagined. What I saw in Ethiopia in a camp run by World Vision and Mother Teresa changed my life. In 85, he said, I'm going to go to Romania where there's darkness, Ceausescu, communism. It was darker in Bucharest, but both kilowatt and evil than any other place, even more than Moscow. We went together. We spent a week together. And when you travel with someone, when you eat with them, when you talk with them, and when you pray for them and pray with them and get in groups, the Spirit just comes. And so our group is based around the teachings of Jesus. And much has come out of that, a lot of legislation and a lot of really important things. And I personally believe, as we look at this environment that we're in, gathering together with one another who may not have completely the same agreements, treating one another with respect, but also the biblical aspect of breaking bread, praying for, praying with, and following the teachings of Jesus, I believe. So we have been meeting now for 35 years. It isn't something that we did 2 years ago, and 1 year I had a very difficult race. He made a contribution to my campaign. I said, you know, you're going to get in trouble. I mean, your leadership, well, he said, I don't really care. And then he offered to do a letter into my district to all of the Democrats saying what a good guy Wolf was. And so things have come out of this and many, many tough votes. And I'll end with this. In 1996, I was one of 8 Republicans voted against seating Newt Gingrich. It was very complicated, the reason I made that decision. That's the vote, the first vote of the session. When you voice your vote loud and everyone's listening, and of course, Tony came, stood on one side of me, Dan Coats came and stood on the other side of me, and I cast that vote. So being in a small covenant group, iron sharpens iron, whereby we were able to be together and our family together, really has literally shaped my time in Congress.
Thank you.
Well, I think Frank has pretty much answered it pretty well. I don't know if I can add much to it. We started meeting together 35 years ago, and a Democrat and a Republican, and we decided not to talk about political issues right away because we felt that if we discuss politics, we wouldn't stay together. We wouldn't have anything in common because oftentimes we'd go to the floor of the House, he'd vote one way, I'd vote the other. So we decided if we would pray together, eat together, travel together, get to know each other first, put aside differences, get to know each other, spend time with each other, let's see what God might do through this. And You know, when you pray together, it's awful hard to get up and go to the floor of the House and start arguing with one another. You can't do it. So after a while, we developed this trust, and we found out that we had a lot of common interest about families and about common issues, and we found out there were things that we could do together. And the things that we didn't agree, we just put them aside. I actually had to go to the Congress of the United States to become a believer. I was not a Christian. I didn't believe in much except myself. I was extremely ambitious and was very successful. When I went to the Congress, I had done well in business and had a great wife, two children, and now I was a U.S. congressman, and I'm thinking, you know, I should be happy. But I came to this conclusion when I got to the Congress that there was something missing there in my life. And so I went on this venture, this I don't know what you call it, this, I went looking for God. And I found him through this person of Jesus. It's a long story, so I won't go into it. Kind of a funny story happened not too long afterwards. I was introduced to this group of people, and my friend got up to me, and it was a large audience full of people and mostly Christians, and he said, "Now, I want to introduce Tony Hall. He's a U.S. congressman and a Christian." People started to laugh, and an older man down front, he was squirming in his chair. Just couldn't take it after a while, and he hollered up. He said, "Make up your mind, buddy. You can't be both." Anyway, I became a believer as a result of going to the Congress. And then, you know, soon after that, I was thrown in with Frank and, you know, to be with a Republican and to test this theory of two people being together. When two people are together in the name of Jesus, he's there. And the fact is that he was. And the spirit was strong, and our relationship has gotten stronger, and we've done some really good things together, passed some laws, and we've grown together. Our wives know each other, and that's kind of really the way it started.
I love to hear your stories because they're inspirational for me in the hope of making friendships that are not constrained by politics. I recently read some statistics having to do with political partisanship, and one of the questions asked in the survey that I was looking at was, how would you feel, it was asked in 1960 and then it was asked again in 2015, and the question was, how would you feel about your daughter or son marrying someone of the opposite political party? And in 1960, Democrats 4% were opposed, and Republicans maybe 6% were opposed. In 2015, the numbers were, I believe, 39% opposed and 45% opposed, just to their son or daughter marrying someone of the opposite political party. Now, that clearly shows to me that political partisanship and a kind of overall identification with politics has gone way up, and it's become much more important to us. Now, first of all, I guess I would ask you both, is that a good thing or a bad thing? I have my own answer, but is it a good thing or a bad thing? And secondly, if it is the case that we are much more partisan now, do you think it's possible for people, say, 40 and under, to recapture the kind of friendship the two of you have? Or has something fundamentally changed in politics?
It's a bad thing, I think. Partisan politics is wrong. I think it's fine to be a Republican or Democrat. You have to choose which one you want to be. I think, personally, as a Democrat, the Democratic Party, the leadership of the Democratic Party, left me a long time ago. The party at the top of my leadership at the top of my party is way too liberal for me. I still remain a Democrat for a number of reasons. The fact is that we're way too partisan. And it's changed in a lot of ways. One of the ways it's changed is because the incredible amount of money that it takes today to get reelected. And that really has hurt not only the two-party system, it's made them more partisan, but it's also, at the same time, hurt our democracy. It takes, on an average, a congressman or woman who's in office, they have to spend on an average of 2.5 hours every day on the phone dialing for money. And if you have to spend 2.5 hours every day to raise money for the next campaign every day of the year, you're not doing your job. That's wrong. So the money in politics today is really different than what it was when I first got in. That's one of the biggest reasons. So it's fine to belong whatever party you believe in and whatever party represents you, but the partisan politics and what's happening with partisan politics is absolutely killing our democracy. And the money that's involved with it, the special interest groups, really, really hurts.
Well, I agree that it's bad, and I think it's really, really bad, but I really see the conditions set in such a way, unless something dramatic happens, it's probably not going to change for several reasons. One, fewer members know each other. They're not in town very much. In the old days, members lived in town. Now they don't live in Washington. They're told not to live in Washington, so you come in on Tuesday, go home on Thursday or Friday. Secondly, the money, as Tony talked about. Thirdly, the political process is very hot. It's MSNBC, there's Fox, there's CNN, there's, you know, Breitbart News, and there's, you know, Drudge, and there's bang, 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 bang. And there's not the time for the reflection. There's not the time for the opportunity. Thirdly, members don't travel anymore. We became great friends traveling to Romania together, going to Africa, going into a refugee camp. I mean, there's a bond that develops. That really isn't taking place anymore. So I really think now Ronald Reagan, President Reagan, who I thought was one of the finest presidents, my three favorite presidents are obviously George Washington, number one, Abraham Lincoln, number two, and Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill used to get together after 5:30 or 6 o'clock at night. I'm not going to tell you that they really liked each other. I don't know what they did. I think Tip felt somewhat threatened with Reagan because Reagan just, shucks. You know, Reagan, the first time we went down to White House, my class met with Reagan. This guy, Jim Nelligan, got up and said, "Mr. President," he said, "you're the only man that looks good in a brown suit." Reagan in his brown suit there isn't a Reagan. There isn't that. And lastly, it tells you about do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I'll tell you something. Nancy Pelosi is a friend of mine. Nancy Pelosi came to more retirement events for me than John Boehner did. Now, I don't agree with Nancy on a lot of issues, but on human rights, on standing up to China, on advocating for the persecuted church. And so I think if you could take the teachings of Jesus and treating other people the same way that you all want to be treated, we want to be treated, I think it can. So I'm not going to say it's not going to come back, but I just haven't seen the ingredients, the environment that sort of lays it out. And with mass communication, the internet, everything's just happening so fast, I think it's going to be very difficult.
I'll pick up with our last comment, which had to do with social media. It didn't directly have to do with social media, but it made me think of social media because in my trying to think of what makes these younger generations, including mine and certainly including the generation of which most college students are members, what makes us different from you all? One of the obvious answers is, of course, social media and the internet and the accessibility of information. And I wonder if you too see that as a potential cause for the heightening of partisanship, because suddenly we are now given multiple sources of news and information, and we can self-select the sources we wish to read and those we don't want to read, we don't read. And so there's a kind of magnification of our own views and an unwillingness to engage with people whose views we don't naturally find ourselves attracted to. Do you think that that is part of the cause for especially the increasing partisanship of people in younger cohorts.
Well, I think the media needs to be held accountable. I don't think they really are held accountable that much. I think the media needs to report the news. I would love to see the media report the news. I don't want to see somebody in the media be a personality. The media, you know, when somebody reports the news is not about the person reporting the news. It's about the news that they're reporting. And it drives me nuts that these people that are reporting the news, they become the news. And so, you know, I don't look at the news on TV anymore. I read several newspapers every morning through the internet. Now, I might start off with the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, Washington Post, you know, several newspapers like that. And I don't like to watch people arguing with one another. To me, that's not news. And it's ugly, and it's not right. I don't like it. And you know, we came up where we had four stations. We had CNN, and CBS, NBC, and ABC. And you know, internet was just starting, and you know, people got their news, they reported their news, and you know, it was much easier in those days. Now, you're right, people can pick and choose, and the news is so slanted, it's just unbelievable. So they're not held accountable, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think the internet and social media has really created a problem. Now, I understand. I have 5 kids, 16 grandkids, and I know that's where it is. But I had it is so hot and so toxic. I had a situation, you can still probably Google it, look it on YouTube. Neil Cavuto. I was the author of the Iraq Study Group. What was going on in Iraq was bad. I think became the Baker-Hamilton Commission. That was an earmark. You know, earmarks are supposed to be bad. That was an earmark to try to do something on Afghanistan. I put the same one in to set up a special commission like the Baker-Hamilton on Afghanistan. Put $1 million in. People were dying. Neil Cavuto had me on the show and said, hit me hard and said, you know, if you ever see the ones they do outside the Capitol, you come to your office, they hook you up, and there's Neil Cavuto. You can't see him, but, you know, you listen to him. And he said, you're an appropriator. You're for earmarks, and they're really bad. And finally, you know, I tried to defend. I said, well, we're at war, and he kept coming at me. Finally, I said, Neil, you don't know what you're talking about. And then he went ballistic. And I wanted to apologize because I shouldn't have put it that way. And what I said is, I try to use a Christian term. I said, Neil, my feet are made of clay. Well, the word went out that I was, I don't drink. I mean, I'm not, you know, maybe I have a sip of wine, but I don't drink. But my office, by the time I got back from the Cannon Rotunda to my office, it had begun. And for 2.5 days, my staff was hammered over and over and over. And then it stopped, and then it started up again. And so there's almost, it was so hot, whereas in the old days, if you said something, people had to buy a stamp and put it on the envelope and write it out. And so it's so immediate now that there's not the time for reflection. There's not the time for explanation. There's not the time to say, you know, I made a mistake and here's what I meant by that. And so I think social media, and I mean, I saw where both of the candidates are twittering at 3 o'clock in the morning. At 3 o'clock in the morning, I pray the Lord, I can sleep. And so it's just not good. And we're dealing with, you know, this is not the city council. This is the United States Congress. This is the one that makes policy on human rights and religious freedom. This is the one that stands by to watch genocide taking place in Iraq and Syria. This is the one that has to come together with policy with regard to China. This is the one that has to say, what's taking place in Nigeria whereby people are being slaughtered? And it's just happening so fast. So it is not good. It is not good. Now, I know that, you know, it's out of the bottle. I mean, and I don't know that you're going to be able to reverse it. I try to discipline myself, you know, to look at my iPad in the morning and my phone. look at it again in the middle of the day, and then look at it at the end of the day. Now, he gets mad at me sometimes. I don't even have answers. So you call me. I don't have a... If I don't answer the phone, you can't find me. I just think it's just becoming so much, and I don't think it's good for the country.
The one thing that strikes me about what both of you have said is that you recognize layers of identity so that you know each other as fathers of children, as husbands, as Christians, as ordinary people who have traveled together and shared experiences that sort of form a common bond. And I think in recognizing that kind of multi-layered identity, you're able to connect on certain issues where you know you're going to disagree on others. And I think that's a lesson perhaps we all should take. Let me turn the conversation to some actual experiences that you had together. And the first of them is your trip to Ethiopia. Each of you has written a book, Prisoner of Conscience and Changing the Face of Hunger. The first was Frank Wolf, the second is Tony Hall. And they began with this trip to Ethiopia, which was undertaken in 1984 during the Ethiopian famine. I know most of you weren't born then. The question I want to ask, though, is how did this change your perspective on the world in general, on politics in particular, and on the issue of hunger and how to remedy it?
Well, I was chairman of the Select Committee on Hunger, or actually it was the Select Committee on International Hunger at that time. And we heard about this terrible famine in Ethiopia. And what happened is that being chairman of the committee, it was incumbent upon me to go to these third world nations and check up on whether our food was getting through and what was going on and to report back to the Congress. And so I went to Ethiopia. I was the first member of Congress to do this, actually the first member of any parliament to go to Ethiopia, because nobody could really understand, because the country had closed down. Nobody was allowed into the country, and it had just opened up. And so I went in, and I went in with Mother Teresa's group, Sisters of Charity, went up country. And I visited this clinic, and as I walked into the clinic, there were about 10,000 people surrounding the clinic, and they were all starving to death because they had been walking for, in some cases, well over 100 miles. They were trying to get away from the Civil War. They were trying to escape the drought, which turned into a famine. They were selling everything. They thought if they got to this clinic, there would be the Red Cross would be there. There would be medicines and food and blankets and water. And there was nothing. There were two nuns. This clinic was no bigger than this stage. And it was myself. I had an aide and two nuns. And when I walked in, I had to walk through 10,000 people, and they all lied down. The mothers were handing me their dead children. I thought I was a doctor. And you can imagine me taking the dead children thinking, what do I do now? So in a period of about 15 minutes, I saw at least 25 children die, plus all the dead children. I never got over that. And for the next 3 days, that's what I saw, a lot of death. And I came home from that experience thinking, and we do a lot of things in Congress that don't amount to much. That's what I was going to concentrate on, hunger, poverty. And just before I went over there, a good friend of mine had come in and had prayed with me. And he said, Tony, don't you think it's time you start to bring God into your workplace? I said, well, how do I do that without looking like a hypocrite? I don't want to wear God on my lapel. I don't want to say, hey, look at me, I'm a Christian, wow. I don't want to say that. I'd rather, let me show a sermon rather than say one. And coming back from that trip, as I began to read the scriptures are just full of passages on poverty, hunger, sickness, refugees, the alien, orphans, widows. It's over 2,500 verses in the Bible. As soon as I got home, I called Frank. I said, Frank, you got to go see this. This will change your life. And so Frank got on the plane. He went to see it as well. It changed our lives. I still think about that, and that was 1984. Changed my life.
Well, the same. I was naive when he called me. I had just gotten on a props and called Congressman Conte and said, I want to go to Ethiopia. He said, yeah, sure, go if you want to. About what by myself. I didn't have any staff. I got into Addis Ababa, and across from the hotel was the Cubans. The Cuban military was there. And I couldn't get up to the famine area. I was by myself. He had a, you know, Godel or whatever they, he had their aid. And so the Washington, and then I was eating one night in the restaurant, frustrated that here I was going to go back as a failure. And Blaine Harden, who later became friends of mine, wrote for the Washington Post, said, Wolf is eating pizza in the hotel. Devastated. I mean, here's, they have good pizza because, as you know, the Ethiopian was controlled by Italy for the longest period of time. And I was frustrated. Finally, I got in touch with World Vision, and they said, we're flying up, and you can come up on a Twin Otter, the very Twin Otter plane that the BBC camera crew had flown up on. We flew up there. What we saw, Corum, and with the Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa and World Vision had a side-by-side camp at Alamata. At the end of the day, we had landed in a field, and I said, can I stay? And the embassy said, no, you can't. And this fellow, Bob Latta, L-A-T-T-A, with World Vision, said, if you stay, I'll stay. And a young Ethiopian guy said, you can sleep in my hut. And I said, I'm staying. And it rained that night. We were in a corrugated hut with a corrugated thing, and it rained. And I thought, this must be good because rain, famine, drought. And, of course, it wasn't. There was no vegetation. But what I saw, not as dramatic as Tony, I didn't see, but just the individuals, and we went into feeding camp. We went out with a Dutch doctor, Peter, and in the morning, women would come out and wail with their kids, and he would give them a little piece of paper if they were really bad to get in. And that was a life-changing trip. I honestly believe, had I not been in a small group, had Tony not called me, had I not gone to Ethiopia, my whole career would have been different. Everything would have been different. And so, you know, Jesus talks a lot about, you know, Matthew 25, when I was hungry, you visited me. So that is, I mean, that was the defining. And if you get my newsletters and look, 81, 82, 83, 84, and then bingo, 85, it was a dramatic, dramatic change. So had I not been in the group, had Tony not called me, had I not seen that, I don't know.
Ambassador Hall, along these lines, and this was a fact I hadn't known about you, in 1993, the House of Representatives abolished the special, the Select Committee on Hunger, and you had served as chairman there for 4 years. In response to this, you fasted for 22 days. Can you tell us a little bit about that, why you did it, what it was like, what you learned?
Yeah. Well, the Congress abolished my committee. And I was stunned because this was the only committee in the Congress that dealt with hunger and poverty and famine in the world. And I thought we had done a wonderful job. Matter of fact, we did. A lot of the laws that are in effect today actually came out of the committee. New York Times called us the conscience of the Congress. And anyway, the Congress said, we've got to start living within our means. We have high deficits. And that was true. And they said, we're going to give the money back to the American people. We're going to start cutting many programs. So they cut my committee. And they said, the first thing we'll do is we'll give the money back to the American people. And they didn't. They took the money and they gave it to the rest of the committees. I was so mad. I was so stunned that I went back home and said to my wife, I think I'm going to quit Congress because these clowns, they don't care about this issue. And they could care less about the poor. And, you know, the poor, they don't have campaign funds and they don't vote. And, you know, they don't have a voice. And you know, they eliminated my committee. So, you know, this is what I really love. And my wife said to me, did you ever think about fasting? And we went and read Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58 is an amazing chapter on fasting. If I'm sure you've read it, some of you have. But if you haven't, read it tonight. It's an amazing chapter. So we prayed about it. 2 days later, I went before Congress and announced that I was going to do a fast. And I fasted for 22 days. I just drank water. That's it. Didn't eat any food. And I basically said to the Congress, I'm not going to eat. I'm just going to drink water. And I'm going to fast until something good happens here because I'm sick and tired of you, congressmen, not caring about this issue. And I'm going to wait until something good happens. Well, I probably thought, this guy's nuts. This guy's crazy. Why would anybody ever do that? No congressman has ever fasted before. And my staff, half of my staff thought I was crazy too. They thought, Tony, you'll never get elected again. Nobody will ever understand this. So I started, and long and behold, it turned out to be amazing. God honored it. It became probably the strongest, most powerful thing I could ever do. I had 10,000 high schools that fasted with me and 200 universities. Now, they didn't fast 22 days. They would take a couple days. Not everybody in the college fasted. Maybe 200 kids in the school would fast a couple days. But the press began to write about it in very good ways, very charming ways, very an editorial from the New York Times, the Washington Post, and different newspapers. And then the networks picked it up, really praised it. And it's just well beyond anything I could have ever done. And then the World Bank decided that they were going to have a world conference on the fast. They invited me to make a speech. They said, come and make a speech and let's see what happens. If you make a good speech, maybe we'll commit some money to this. So I did. They, over a period of a few years, they committed $100 million to the fast. And it went out mostly to women for microcredit, microfinance. And they charged an interest on it, you know, loans of $100, $120. It all came back. It's all paid back. Went out again through interest. It's now up to $500 million. A lot of jobs and stuff like that. One fast. So I never got my committee back. I never even asked for it back. But it was God ordered, God orchestrated. It was the most powerful thing I did in Congress. No legislation, no power, no campaign, no money, just fasted. God did the rest.
That's a remarkable story. I'd like to turn to a topic that follows naturally from this, which is the question of religious freedom and the defense of religious freedom. I know Mr. Wolf has told us a lot about his experience in defending religious freedom. He's our endowed chair here at Baylor, and he's been here for last year and this year as well. But I wonder if both of you might say a few words about how the issue of religious freedom came to be of such vital importance to you and where you see the situation today in terms of the defense of religious freedom.
Well, Madison said conscience is the most sacred of all property, and religious freedom, religious liberty, in the Constitution. I think we are, without getting too deep domestically, we're beginning to see things that I think are very uncomfortable. But let me take you abroad. Today we have, in China, we have Catholic bishops under house arrest, Protestant pastors in jail. Xiaobo, the 2010 Nobel Prize winner, is in jail, and nobody raises his name. I snuck into Tibet in the mid-90s. You've had this last year, you've had 140 Tibetan monks and nuns who poured kerosene on the body, set themselves aflame, and just, you see in Iraq, in Iraq we had it was 1.5 million Christians in Iraq before the war broke out. They're now down to 200 to 250,000. We see religious freedom, you know, diminishing in Vietnam. We see almost none in North Korea, but what's taking place to the persecuted church. And I think it is very, very important. 70-some percent, according to the Pew survey, 74 actually, live in a religiously repressive nation. and the ability to practice your own faith, to follow your conscience. All of us, whether we be Christian, whether we be Jewish, whether we be Muslim, whether we be Buddhist, our conscience is what motivates us to do what we did for our behavior. And the loss of losing religious freedom, both domestically, but particularly as we see, and I don't want to equate what's taking place domestically, although we are beginning to lose it, with what's taking place internationally. No one is being taken away here in the United States because of their activity and their beliefs. But we are seeing the diminishing of religious freedom around the world, even in places. China is worse today than it was 10 to 15 years ago. Russia, if you've been following, is beginning to clamp down. And I think human rights and religious freedom. President Reagan said that the words in the Constitution and the words in the Declaration of Independence, the Declaration of Independence is the document. Reagan said they were a covenant, not only with the people in Philadelphia in 1776, in 1787 when the Constitution was ratified. But Reagan said they were a covenant with the entire world. They were a covenant with Sister Diana, the nun that we were with in Northern Iraq. They were a covenant with the tank man. You remember the tank man stood up in Tiananmen. They were a covenant with the people in Syria today. They're a covenant what's taking place with Boko Haram is doing to the Christian community in Nigeria. They were a covenant, and that covenant is being shredded. And I think if we allow to continue, I think we're going to be in deep trouble. And lastly, any country where there's religious freedom and human rights is a country that generally flourishes, but it's also a country that is not at war with its neighbor.
Frank is pretty much my guru on this. I listen to him on religious freedom because he understands it better than I do. So if he says, Tony, you need to be involved in China, or you need to be involved with me with Romania, I listen to him. He kind of listens to me on hunger. So this is how we kind of work together. I think we first got involved with religious freedom on the, I think it was on Romania, mm-hmm. when we first went together, and that was under this dictator by the name of Ceausescu, and he was a terrible religious leader where they had amazing persecution in this country of Romania, where they would bulldoze churches down, and they took 100,000 Bibles that were sent into the country from Americans, and they turned it into toilet paper. And we just saw all kinds of people that, as we would go to these churches that were bulldozed down, people would come up to Frank and I, and they would stuff notes into our pockets, my uncle, my father, my brother, my son, they're in prison. Please help us get them out. And so that probably was our first experience with religious persecution. We came home from that trip to Romania. Frank took his daughter and I took my wife. And we took Most Favored Nation. We fought to take Most Favored Nation trading status away from Romania, because we felt, why should we give a country Most Favored Trading Nation status, when they treat their citizens like this? So that kind of was our first experience with religious persecution. But since then, I kind of listened to what Frank does. He knows religious persecution better than I do, and that's how we started.
Well, let me ask Mr. Wolf another question. I know that you had visited Nigeria in February of this year, where Boko Haram notoriously kidnapped more than 300 schoolgirls in 2014. We all heard this story. It's all faded from our consciousness, but it's not faded in actuality. So I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what that experience was like, what you saw, and what the conditions for religious minorities look like there.
Well, we went up into the middle of the Boko Haram area. We went to Jos. We talked to the families of some of the girls who've been kidnapped. Boko Haram is the most dangerous terrorist group in the world. They have killed more people than ISIS. Secondly, they have pledged allegiance to ISIS. The fourth most dangerous terrorist group in the world are the Fulani herdsmen, who have killed a lot of Christians. The Christian community said over and over, we were not with the American embassy, we went by or by ourselves, said, Mr. Wolf, does the church in the West care about us? And what has taken place there, we went in and we talked to a counselor who counsels the parents of the girls. And only one of the girls who actually was kidnapped, some jumped off the bus and jumped off the truck and ran away, but only one who was kidnapped has been released. The counselor said, here's what they tell the parents. One, your daughter will never come back unless it's a major effort by the West, including the United States. Secondly, your daughter will have been assaulted, and she will either be with child or she will be pregnant. Third, your daughter will have been forced to convert. She will now be a Muslim. And the mother's hearts break. We brought over one of the mothers in June of this year when we released our report. When the West did hashtag bring back our girls, the mothers and fathers were excited about it because they thought that meant. But in essence, when the West, including Prime Minister Cameron, did hashtag bring back our girls, it was counterproductive because it really put a ransom on them. They are now hostage of Boko Haram. They have value. Boko Haram knows that they have value. And so some of the girls have died. If you listen to the one girl that got out, some have died. So now it's been, this April was 2 years. 2 years. And so I think fundamentally the West has failed these parents. Keep in mind, number one terrorist group. Lastly, Bono, Tony knows Bono well, the Irish rock star, was interviewed about two months ago. He said the fracturing of Nigeria, there are 180 million people there. It's a large country. The fracturing of Nigeria is an existential threat to Europe and to almost the rest of the world. Look at the impact that there are 25 million people in Syria. 1 million have gone north, and you see the impact on Europe. Now you're beginning to get the reports of Nigerians that are beginning to move. And Boko Haram has impacted on Nigeria, on Cameroon, on Chad, on Niger and others. So it is literally an existential threat. And lastly, just Google it. Just go when you go. Famine. There's a famine taking place in northern Nigeria, and the world is silent. The world is quiet. There are no refugee planes going up. There are no World Visions going in. There aren't any CNN and Fox and kids. It's quiet. And thousands of kids are dying, and the West is silent. And you never hear anything about the Chibok girls, and nobody ever said hashtag bring back our girls, and they're fundamentally, they are forgotten.
In just a few minutes, we'll open up the floor for questions from the audience. But let me ask my final question, which probably will have been brought up in your minds, as it has been in mine, by the discussion up here today. On the issues of hunger and religious liberty across the world, but also in the United States, what might we do to become a part of a solution? Is there anything that ordinary Americans who are not congressmen can do to make these situations any better?
Well, I'll tell you what Mother Teresa told me. I had the pleasure of being with her a number of times in my lifetime. Matter of fact, I went to her funeral. First time I visited her, she said, do the things in front of you. And she said that not everybody can come to Calcutta like you can. Go home and tell everybody, do the things in front of you. What she was saying was, look, people did the things in front of them. They took care of their neighbor, they volunteered at the church, took care of the person that nobody pays attention to, if they gave some money here and there, if they worked at a food bank, if they, whatever they did, do the thing that's in front of you. She was saying that if everybody did that in the world, probably half the stuff we do in the government, we wouldn't need to do. And she said, you know, no matter what, it doesn't matter if it's a drop, because if you put all your drops together, pretty soon you're going to have a stream, maybe a river. You're going to change the world. So do it. Do the thing that's in front of you. So you don't have to change the world. You just change the thing around you. Because if we all change the thing around us, it'll make a difference.
Well, the answer is yeah. Every time you leave the group, whether it be in China, whether it be in Iraq, whether it be in Nigeria, first thing they say, they don't ask for more, they say, pray for us. So prayer. Secondly, advocacy. There used to be, when we passed the International Religious Freedom Commission, there used to then be a day of prayer for the persecuted church. It was always the first weekend in November. Now only a handful of churches have it, so you can advocate. Thirdly, there are a lot of different groups. The Dominican Sisters are doing a tremendous job. Franklin Graham's group, Samaritan's Purse. We are seeing the end of Christianity in the cradle of Christendom. More biblical activity took place in Iraq than any other country of the world other than Israel. Abraham, that's Nasiriyah in Iraq. Ezekiel buried in Iraq. Daniel is buried in Iraq. Esther is from Iraq. ISIS, about a year and a half ago, blew up Jonah's tomb in Nineveh. There are groups now that are looking to establish a Christian and Shabak and also Turkmen and Yazidi community, because the Yazidis are being persecuted. The Congress has called a genocide. The president, the administration has called a genocide, but nothing's being done. So there are groups trying to aid to keep the people there. We think that everyone wants to come here. When I asked most of the people that they did not want to come here, they would say, Mr. Wolf, help us stay. But if you won't help us stay, help us go. So by joining churches, and I know you have the one group here at Antioch Church, and you have but helping the Christian community continue to live in those places. So there is so much. Again, Sister Diana, the Dominican Sisters, Franklin Graham, Samaritan's Purse, and also different groups that are helping to work. There are some that want to come. When they want to come, we help them come. But let's keep Christianity in the cradle of Christendom so we don't see it end. There's a group out of England that says in 6 years, now it's a year old, in 5 years, there will be no Christians left in the cradle of Christendom. There is a saying in the Middle East, first the Saudi people, then the Sunni people. The Saudi people, the Jewish community. In 1948, the Jewish population of Iraq was 150,000. When I was there, I said, how many Jewish people are left? They said, Mr. Wolf, about officially 10 individuals, but maybe down to 4. What is taking place to the Jewish community is now taking place to the Christian community. So by praying, advocating, adopting a family, working with Samaritan's Purse, Voice of the Martyrs, the Dominican Sisters in the Catholic Church, and then finding some of the groups that are working to reestablish the Christian Shabak, Turkmen, and Yazidi. They all want to work together. Protectorate in that region, in the Nineveh Plains, can do a lot. So there's a lot that you can do. You remember, and I'm getting trained of thought, you remember the young student that did Coney? Charles Coney, one guy, he had the world electrified with the internet, with social media. You can do, one of you that took an issue like this on could do so much. Yes, there's a lot that could be done.
I'd like to invite anyone in the audience who has a question on any of these topics or anything else related to what it's like to be a congressman. Please come forward.
Hello, my name is Daniel West, and I would like to ask, with all your tough votes in the House, was there a particular place in Scripture that you would go to for wisdom or solace or kind of looking for God's God to speak into your vote?
Yes, you would pray about it. Probably the toughest vote that I cast. The two toughest votes, they're really in different categories. One is a sin. American soldiers, men and women, to war. That one, because that's on your conscience. The other one is the vote that I cast not to seat Newt Gingrich. And I talked to Tony about that, and I talked to Dan Coates, Senator Coates, about it. I obviously talked to my best advisor is my wife. If it wasn't for my wife, I'd be a claims adjuster at Geico right now. She is just literally. And so, and then I pray a lot about it. And you agonize, and you just, and then when the time comes. But yeah, you pray, and you go to your friends and counsel. One of my mentors was Chuck Colson. On Tough Votes, I used to call Chuck. One of my kids married one of Chuck's aides. The guy used to travel with Chuck, Hal Whitman. They run a Christian school up in Princeton. And I used to call Chuck, and Chuck would just, Chuck Colson combined the hard-headed reality of, he was a tough Marine, with the faith walk. And so, yeah, but you pray, you think, you talk, and you listen to people that you have a lot of confidence in, that you respect, and then you just suck it up, and you go out, and you just do it.
Tell me your question again. Were you asking for a particular scripture, or tell me your question again.
Yeah, is there a particular place in Scripture that you go to kind of find wisdom for in either voting or kind of making tough choices in your time in the Congress or for Mr. Ambassador Hall in the international stage?
Well, I told you about Isaiah 58, and that was very, very relevant. And I was, you know, when I became a believer, when I was a freshman congressman, I, up until that time, I was not a believer. I was pro-choice on abortion, and I didn't. I'm the kind of guy that if you try to push me and try to be tough with me, I'll come right at you. Don't use that kind of stuff on me, because I had a large Catholic constituency, and they would always just drive me nuts being, you know, pro-choice, and they wanted me to be pro-life, and man, they would do all kind of threatening and stuff like that. I'm the wrong guy to do that with. Anyway, when you try to force faith down people's throats, that's the worst thing you can do. Because you can't force faith down people's throats if they're not a believer. So, I mean, it's crazy. Then I became a believer, and it was the Holy Spirit that changed me. I'm reading my scripture one night, and it was not so much what I remember when I read. I was reading the scripture one night, and I'm thinking, oh, jeez. Is sacred. Went to the Congress the next day and changed my vote. Became a pro-life. It was the Holy Spirit that changed me, not what anybody said. And from that day on, I became a pro-life person. So it was the Spirit that changed me. I can't even remember the passage I was reading that night, but it was the Holy Spirit that changed me.
It sounds like both of you share Christian ideologies. But being a Republican and a Democrat, I assume, but you know, you're either conservative and liberal, and both of those worldviews have their own ideologies. Were there any times in your friendship with each other that the political ideology that comes with being either conservative or liberal clashed with each other and got in the way of your friendship?
The answer to no, not really. He may come up with one, but I don't think so. When there were big, deep issues, the political party issues, I mean, he obviously wasn't going to vote for the Republican speaker, and I obviously wasn't going to vote for the Democrat. I mean, but we never, if there was something so big, we just didn't deal with it. We found commonalities. So the answer is no.
I basically was a Democrat mainly because, you know, I was in the Peace Corps, and I basically believed in the early days of the Democratic Party, I love the idea that they believed in the working person, the working man, a fair wage. I believed in helping the poor. I really did. I mean, this is what I think the Democratic Party should be about. Somewhere along the line, the Democratic Party got, their leadership got way too liberal. I don't know what happened there, but crazy. And Frank and I have never really had any major disagreements. Now, he's helped me on some issues. Like, I was never anti-gambling. Frank is very anti-gambling. But I listened to him about gambling, and he told me, you know, he did a lot of background research on gambling, why it was bad, how it affects people, how it really destroys families and stuff like that. I mean, I used to love to go to Las Vegas and gamble. I mean, I loved it. I mean, I wasn't an addict or anything, but I enjoyed it. I haven't been to Las Vegas in 25 years because of him. Because I listened to him, and he had good research on it. And he told me about the way it changed people, and especially the poor, the way it affected the poor. And so, we've changed each other's opinion about things. But I don't think we've ever had a major argument.
No.
He might vote differently on taxes than I do. He might vote a little bit differently on foreign affairs than I do. But, you know, for the most part, we're close on a lot of issues. A lot of issues.
You said, Mr. Hall, that the news is becoming too slanted. So being a first-time voter, how would you recommend watching the news and reading the news so you get a more holistic view on the two candidates?
I would say, if you don't know the candidate, you don't feel good about the candidate, don't vote on that candidate. But vote. Go into the voting booth and vote for the issues. Vote. I mean, do vote. But if you don't, if you don't feel comfortable, you shouldn't, you know, on the issue, I wouldn't vote for either one. But you should vote, and you should do research. And don't vote party line. You vote, you look at what they want. If you want to vote for more Republicans than Democrats, fine. Or vice versa. But don't go down that party line, because we got idiots on both sides. Don't do that.
Mulling over a question since we last met, and the issues that you've addressed today, religious liberty and hunger, are obviously immensely pressing questions. And the age that I've grown up in, the people that I've grown up with, seem to have grown up in this era of media in which debate is always emphasized, and this is the lesson that they've been taught over and over again. And it seems like most kids my age don't have an ability to dialogue, but seeing you up here today, you both obviously do. So my question is, what is the message or the virtue that you would emphasize in reteaching a generation to dialogue?
Well, I think you should. Some of my best friends are Democrats, and, you know, we just differ at times. Sometimes I'll go home and say, well, I can't understand, you know, why they differ. But we're all different. I come from a Democrat. I'm the first person in my family to go to college. My dad went to sixth grade, my mom to seventh grade. My mom made sandwiches in a cafeteria, and my dad was a policeman. I didn't go to college for 2 years. I got out of high school. And I worked for a Curtis Publishing Company. They put out Jack and Jill, Saturday Evening Post, Ladies Home Journal. I had a ducktail. I used to wear pistol pocket pants. You don't know what they are, but there's a big stitch down them. I had box toe loafers. I went to Bandstand. I dated Ginny O'Callaghan, president of Bandstand. And all of a sudden, a couple of people at Curtis Publishing Company directly across from Independence Hall said, have you ever thought of going to college? And just encouraged me. I went back. I went to prep school at nighttime. I couldn't get into college, really. It took me a long time. So I come from a Democratic background. His father was the Republican mayor of Dayton. So I think it's just kind of all. But I think you ought to do unto others you would have them do. Listen, think. If you want to change culture, though, I think sometimes you look in terms, everything that takes place in Congress is downstream from culture. I mean, listen what Wilberforce said. You should read the book by Hannah Moore. Wilberforce tells Hannah Moore that takes place outside of the parliament has a greater impact than what takes place in the parliament. They use pottery bills. They use songs. They use plays. And it used to be, here's the legislative body, culture shapes it. It used to be the church. The faith community would shape it. And so I believe that the church needs to advocate and speak out. Speak out for treating one another. Speak out for the poor. Speak out for the issue of, I mean, I think one of the thou shalt not steal, one of the greatest stealing we were just talking at the beginning is a $20 trillion debt that we will live well off of. And you will not, because you're going to have to pay. But I think everything that takes place in the institution is downstream from culture. And what culture ought to be shaped by people of faith in the church. So you all can pretty much dictate how this thing is going. Now, right now, we're not seeing the culture. We're not seeing the church trying to shape those. The people of faith, Dr. Brantley, you know Dr. Brantley? Samaritan's Purse. He got Ebola. He got Ebola because of his faith in Jesus. Mother Teresa was over there, why? Because of her faith in Jesus. Thomas More did what he did. Why did Dietrich Bonhoeffer give his life? Why? And so I think the faith community, frankly, I think we need more Bonhoeffers. Read, I'll end with this. Read Dr. Martin Luther King's letter from Birmingham jail. It is so powerful. He expresses grave disappointment in the church. He said, I thought when I was active in this, the church would be mythy, and they were not. So I think you all have the ability, the church, the faith community, ought to be shaping the culture, which then has the impact with regard to what takes place in government and Congress.
I would say get yourself a prayer partner. It's most important to have a prayer partner. You know, iron sharpens iron. Get somebody different than you. If you're a Republican, don't get another Republican. If you're a Democrat, don't get another Democrat. Get a Republican. Get somebody different that thinks different than you. Secondly, you know, when Paul wrote his letter to the Thessalonians, he said that, you know, when Timothy and Silvanus and I came to see you, we had three things. We had power, we had the Holy Spirit, we had true conviction. That letter was written by three people. It wasn't just written by Paul. And so when three people go together, you have power, you have Holy Spirit, you have the Holy Spirit, you have true conviction. And Jesus sent his people out two by two. So get yourself a prayer partner, get somebody different than you. You know, in this college, a lot of people here are the same. You know, a lot of you think alike. Get somebody different here. And get somebody who thinks differently. And get yourself a prayer partner. I tell you, it's probably the most important thing I've learned in the last probably 15 years is to... Well, actually, Frank has been a prayer partner for 35 years. But I also have another prayer partner, and he goes with me every place. When I moved to Rome, he moved to Rome with me, him and his wife, just to be my prayer partner. If I go to North Korea, he goes to North Korea with me. If I go to the Congo, he goes and he prays with me every morning. And the power that two people have when you go together, when one person's tired, the other person is not tired. When one person is articulate, maybe the other person is not so articulate. But two people going together, God is with you. And that's the way he did it. It's not that you can't do it by yourself, but it's much easier to do it with another person. And I think one of the most valuable lessons I've learned is to go out two by two.
A lot of people think Baylor is this conservative Southern Baptist school, but it's an amazingly diverse campus. I mean, probably in the election it'll be 50% Republican, 50% Democrat. And, you know, as our campus kind of wrestled, like last year, with some of the race issues that were happening on other campuses, as we go into this election, I think Baylor has this unique opportunity to be a really distinct Christian voice, and how can we best do that to demonstrate to the world what a fairly balanced, diverse set of people on this campus, you know, addressing and maybe differing on some of the issues around the election, around how to deal with race or poverty or any other issue. I mean, obviously, with I think your encouragement for prayer, even across, you know, other types of divisions. Any other thoughts or suggestions? Because I think Baylor is a really could be a unique example to the country of what real friendship with differences might look like.
Well, if you could demonstrate some of the things that, you know, we're talking about, doing the thing that's in front of you, praying together, small groups, helping the poor. These things really add up. People see this stuff, they say, I want to be part of that. I want a piece of that. This is what I want for my children. That's the kind of school I want to send my son, my daughter to. It's the kind of community I want to live in. I mean, you can change so much just by your example. You don't have to say much. I know that people will come up to you and say, why do you do this? And they will. They'll come and ask you, why do you do this? And then you can tell them. And you can be a wonderful example to the world. And I'm sure you are. I mean, Baylor is an amazing university. I mean, you've got a wonderful reputation. But you can do more. You can do the thing that's in front of you, what Mother Teresa says. Just think if we started to do the thing that's in front of us. Take care of our problems. Take care of nobody pays attention to this student. Nobody pays attention to this person. Do you have a hunger problem here? You got a homeless problem here? You got a refugee problem here? Let's take care of it. Pretty soon people are gonna notice. I don't know what your problems are here. You know. Look.
St. Francis said, I'd rather see a sermon than hear a sermon. I think how you live your life, what you do. Baylor is that, you know, I go on a lot of college campuses. This is an authentically Christian school. And I think it's important not to drift. There are some schools that have drifted. And I believe that the teachings of Jesus is kind of the way to go. And so that, I mean, you are not going to follow Christ and be attacking people, condemning people. And so I just think to follow, to be authentic, and this is a good school. I've met a lot of your students, and it is an authentic Christian school, and it is important to be there. In a world of darkness and where I see things taking place, I mean, I think you want to be light and you want to do things. So I think there's a lot that you can do. It's not going to end just here at Baylor. It's what you do when you get out. Many of you will run for Congress. Some of you will go into ministry. Many of you will be, you know, raised to great families. Other will be professors. Other will be, but I think the ability to take the authentic Christian message of Jesus out into the world will do more than anything. And lastly, what I pray for at night when I pray, I have 16 grandkids. I go through each and every kid. I have 5 kids and then all my grandkids by name. I always and I pray for a spiritual awakening. I mean, where's the Whitfield? Where's the Jonathan Edwards? An awakening. And we have had awakenings, and I think this country right now needs an awakening. And quite frankly, let it be that it begins here at Baylor. Let it begin. But if this country does not have a spiritual awakening, we're going to come through some very, very tough times. I'm not going to say we're going to see the end of America. I mean, there's still a Portugal. I mean, it's not the country it used to be. Things are happening. So I think what we need in this country is a spiritual awakening. And I think a lot depends on you. A lot depends on the church. And as of now, the church has been relatively silent.
Well, let's say a very big thank you to both Ambassador Hall and Frank Wolf.